Super Mothman, written in 2015 and based on a story prompt. He had Pringle crumbs all over his chest when he woke up. His laptop was slipped over beside him on the bed, probably from his restlessness while he slept. Streaks of sunlight cut across the room. He could see a figure sitting in an antique chair in the corner. He swung his legs over the edge of the bed and brushed the crumbs onto the floor as he asked, "When did you..." Before he could finish, the figure stood up from the darkness. "We have work to do," said the man. "How did you get in my house?" he asked, standing from his bed. "It's not important," said the mysterious man, "but what is important is an offer I have for you." "An offer? I don't even know who you are. Get out of my house before I call the cops," he replied. "You can just call me John. And if you call the cops, you'll miss out on the offer." "I'm willing to pay you a lot of money," said the figure, standing from the chair. "Well, okay, John. What do I have to do in return?" "I need you to become a symbol. A superhero, in a way, really. Think of it as me hiring you as a character actor, or a mascot. I simply need you to dress in a certain way, go out at night, and make sure you're seen," said John. "Why do you need me to do this?" he asked. "Does it even matter?" "Look, kid, I'll pay you $5,000 now, and $5,000 when it's done, if you can pull this off," said John. "Why me, of all people?" he asked. "Let's just say, your prime location. Also, you're very reclusive. You like to be alone, and let's face it, very few people know you live here, or even exist at all," said John. "Fair enough. Okay, I'm in. So what is it that I have to wear? A superhero outfit?" he asked. John picked up the briefcase he had lying next to him in the antique chair, and handed it to him. As he took the case and looked down to open it, John had left the room. Inside the briefcase, he found the first $5,000 in a gray morph suit, with leather wings attached to the arms and back. The head had two large red lights made into them. "You've got to be kidding me," he thought. Later that night, he put on the suit and went out. He wasn't sure what he was supposed to be doing. All he knew to do was to be seen, and so he was. He perched on rocks and mountains by roadsides. He ran in front of cars, climbed trees, hid in bushes, and always made sure that the frightened citizens saw him, his wings, and especially his large red eyes. He continued to do this for months. He had grown to like it, scaring people, enjoying the outdoor, the cold night air, and the beautiful West Virginia wilderness. When over a year had passed, he got another visit from the strange man known as John. He appeared again in the antique chair. "Congratulations on a job well done," said John. "The locals really know you're here now," John continued, holding up a newspaper. The headline read, "Strange Creature Sightings in West Virginia." John looked at him. "Before I can give you the other $5,000, I need you to focus on bridges. Go to the Silver Bridge, climb around on it, draw attention to it. Once you do that, our work will be finished and you will never need to wear the suit again," said John. "But I like wearing the suit. Can I not still do this after I get my payment?" he asked. "No," said John aggressively. "You need to disappear after this is over. You cannot be in the papers after we are done here. I want no more sightings after tonight. You'll go in the bridge, do whatever you do, and then I'll give you the $5,000 and take back the suit," said John.
Okay, sorry. Well, it was fun while it lasted," he said, as John left the room.
That night, he got dressed into his suit and hung out at the bridge. He carefully climbed around on it and ran across it several times. Many eyewitnesses had seen him. His job was done. He went to sleep as the morning sun lit the darkness in a light faded yellow outside his window. He awoke midday and heard the terrible news being reported on the television. Tragedy had struck. The very bridge he had been on had fallen. That night, John showed up again. And the moment he saw John, he was enraged. "What did you do?" he screamed angrily. "Me? Why would you assume I did anything?" said John smugly. "Don't play games with me, John, if that is your real name. 46 people are dead. What did you do?" he demanded. John pulled out the $5,000 and tried to hand it to him. "I don't want that. I should never have taken this offer. I should never have associated with you. I'll find out who you are and report you to the authorities. There will be justice for what happened here," he said. "You'll never be able to tie me to this crime. There's no proof. So good luck. Now give me the suit," said John. "No," he replied. "Give me the suit. No." He and John got into a fight. John tried to take away the suit, but he fought back. They struggled back and forth, hitting and pushing each other until they were standing in front of the window. With all his force, John pushed him out the window, shattering the glass and sending him falling down the two-story drop. He landed in a dumpster, still holding onto the suit. John looked at the window, but he could not see where he went. John left, and was never seen or heard from again. Meanwhile, our hero emerged from the dumpster, suit in hand, badly beaten and hurt from the fall, but still alive. He knew what he must do. He must turn his misfortune into a symbol of hope.
a symbol for truth and justice. He must tell the citizens of West Virginia that they no longer need fear tragedy. They no longer need to fear the creatures of the night. John had told him to never wear the suit again, so naturally, in direct defiance, he would be seen everywhere. He and the people who met their fate on that bridge would have justice. He is no longer a puppet on strings. He is no longer a pawn to be moved. He does not work for money. He strikes hard and fades away into the night. He is vengeance. He is the night. He is West Virginia. He is the Mothman.